Daniel Porter, thank you. Welcome. Thanks for joining me today.
Yeah, thanks for having me. Glad to be here.
So when it comes to really alleviating drought, how much do the monsoons help versus how much does our snowpack help?
I think for the winter season, that's what we're really looking for, because we're looking in the higher elevations, we're looking for snowpack, snow accumulations that are piling up in the higher terrain. And then as you get into the spring months, that eventually slowly melts and works its way through the reservoir system, through the streams and rivers and what have you. The challenge that you face during the monsoon season, while the precipitation is certainly welcome, a lot of times it can be spotty in nature. You have the haves and have-nots, and that can happen on a daily basis. But sometimes, you don't get enough precipitation during the monsoon season to help the drought situation. So what you're looking for is persistent light to moderate precipitation. You really get that during the winter season, and it impacts a larger area of the state versus in the monsoon season. It can be pretty spotty at times.
And here in the Southwest, we're always paying attention to whether it's going to be El Nino or La Nina. Can you sort of just give us the brief overview of what those two different systems mean for the Southwest and maybe what we're looking ahead to in the next few months, next 6 months?
Oh, absolutely. So El Nino is and La Nina is, we are focused on the central and eastern Pacific, the sea surface temperatures there. So a deviation in what we consider normal for that region. Right now we are what we call insoneutral. So the temperatures in the central and eastern Pacific are near normal. And what that does is that it changes the weather patterns across the northern hemisphere. And it's really a phenomenon that we really pay attention to during the winter and spring months, because there's a little bit more of a direct correlation with wetter patterns across the northern America. And with that being said, there's not a direct correlation for the next couple of months for the monsoon season. If you have an El Nino pattern going on in the eastern Pacific, you do have better chances for tropical cyclones to develop, because the waters are warmer across that area. And then if you get the right upper level pattern across the desert Southwest, that could tug some of that moisture northward into the desert Southwest. So that it could be one small correlation we see with El Nino during the monsoon season. But across the winter and spring months, what we're looking for is El Nino across our region, because that tugs the storm track further towards the south into the desert Southwest. And as you have more storms move through the region, you have greater chances for precipitation. And so it tilts your odds a little bit more in favor of more of a near to above normal season. What we are looking at right now for this upcoming 2021-2022 winter season is the numerical models have come into some sort of agreement that we might be faced with another round of La Nina conditions. And usually for New Mexico, the storm track's too far north, and that reduces the opportunity for storms to move through the region. And so generally in that pattern, we see below normal precipitation and above normal temperatures. That's not to say storms won't come through the region and they won't be impactful to New Mexico. We still get significant winter storms that move through the region during that time, and we need to be prepared for those type of scenarios. But the frequency of those events are probably going to be fewer than when we're in neutral or El Nino. And just kind of an interesting stat that I kind of looked at before we came on the show here is when we do the double dip into La Nina, so we had a La Nina, we've kind of come out of it, and it's now forecast to go back into La Nina. Those are historically terrible seasons for New Mexico. We are usually below normal in the precipitation department. So we kind of need to keep our fingers crossed that the La Nina that is forecast to occur in the coming months, in the fall and in the winter season, isn't going to be as severe as in past.
So right now, looking around the state, like much of the state is in drought conditions. We're seeing our rivers low and drying, our reservoirs are low. So we should not be thinking like, oh, let's just keep our fingers crossed for a good snowpack and next year we'll be okay.
Yeah, absolutely. It looks like we really need to hang our hat a little bit on this monsoon season and hope we get quite a bit of precipitation during the season and we can capture some of that water that we're receiving during the next couple of months. But as we go into the winter and into the spring months, it looks like we might not see as much snowpack in the higher elevations. And that will certainly translate to a challenging spring for 2022 because it could intensify the drought situation. The fuels across the region will continue to dry out. And then once we get those westerlies that we're all so familiar with in New Mexico, when the winds really start to pick up and the humidities drop off, and we've already got drought, that's a recipe for extreme fire behavior. And that would be something we'd be monitoring very closely next spring.
So one of the things that we know about our changing climate is we'll continue to see a rise in temperatures. When it comes to precipitation, however, or the future of the monsoon season, what do we know about those changes into the future?
Yeah, the North American monsoon is already a complicated and not fully well understood system that impacts the western United States. Now you add climate change into the equation where temperatures are warming, that kind of takes things out of balance a little bit. And so it becomes even more challenging to predict what future monsoon seasons across the desert Southwest may be faced with. But as you have a warming climate, temperatures continue to warm, the droughts continue to become more severe, the region becomes much more arid and what have you. There is some modeling out there that suggests that as well as the temperatures warm, there's an opportunity for more water vapor to be available in the atmosphere. And so when you do get a storm that does impact your region, you get the right weather pattern to set up across your region, it could be more intense in nature because there's more water vapor available for storms to work with in the atmosphere. And so it's kind of a double-edged sword a little bit. When you have the severe droughts that do develop, but then when you do have storm systems move through, they could be heavy rainfall producers. And so you're faced with drought, and then you're also faced with the flash flood risks that come with those heavy thunderstorms.
So speaking of that, these storms that we saw like in Doña Ana County or that caused flooding in Berlin or Carlsbad, are these considered extreme weather events or kind of how do they fit into that narrative?
So, you know, for the monsoon season, we always face the risk for flash flooding. And it's always amplified as well when you have wildfire burn scars, urban development, and what have you. And so those challenges have always been there, and they will continue to be an issue going forward. Whether or not we can pinpoint specific events as to whether or not it's related to climate change is very difficult to ascertain. But I would say that the risk for those heavy rainfall events moving forward, the frequency of those are most likely going to increase as we continue to have a warming climate.
So one of the things that we've talked about on this show before is how our warming climate kind of sets us up to not always have a sense of normal, that there can be dry periods, there can be very wet periods, it's sort of can be very unpredictable. And I'm curious if you could talk a little bit about that in terms of how we can anticipate what our weather patterns will be like as we have a changing climate.
That's an interesting question and one that many of us may not necessarily know the answers to because we are looking at numerical models now and we see the patterns that we anticipate for the upcoming season, but then maybe they don't pan out. Is it because of the poor model performance or is it because of a changing climate across the region? So it's always, it seems like it's a bit of a moving target a little bit because we're facing something that we've not faced with before in the most recent years, decades, and centuries. So,
Daniel, thank you so much for joining me today.
You're welcome. Thanks for having me here.